Welcome to Hit Voice. This is your channel for exploring new issues and developments in healthcare and technology. I'm Karen Song. Today we'll be discussing the importance of fostering community around health IT and the challenges to the adoption of technology in healthcare with Matthew Holt. Matt started the healthcare blog, which the Wall Street Journal says is, and I quote, among the most widely read insider publications in the field. He also co-founded Health 2.0, a series of conferences bringing together thought leaders and innovators in healthcare. Later, we'll follow up with Skype questions from influential leaders who would like to ask Matt the hard questions. Matt, welcome.
Thanks, Karen. Glad to be here.
Could you talk a bit about the healthcare blog and your motivations for starting it?
Sure. So funnily enough, back in the early 2000s, I was one of the many people who worked in the dot-com business. I was in a healthcare startup and found myself with not much to do after that. Okay. I'd also been on the beach in Asia and wandered around and had a travel blog. And I came back and in the early 2000s, 2003, just a few people were starting these political blogs. You may remember Instapundit and The Daily Coast were all just getting going. And I thought, well, someone must be doing this for healthcare. I knew a bit about healthcare and nobody was. So lo and behold, that's where the healthcare blog started. I think the first month there were 83 visits. My father had just retired. He was kind of, he had some spare time on his hands at that point. But, you know, since then, obviously, I spent a lot of time writing and working on it. And over time, it's grown to become a group blog covering basically any and every issue in healthcare.
Wow. I mean, that's really fantastic. How did you get such a following?
Well, honestly, you know, being first was a big part of it and getting indexed by Google, but also religiously sort of publishing several times a day, covering lots of different issues that that came up with it. And then pretty soon after that, getting other people who I associated with in the healthcare business, whether healthcare IT or healthcare policy, to also write on the site and comment on the site. So it's really been a sort of labor of love over many years.
Are you surprised at the following that it has?
Well, in some ways, I'm amazed that anybody would pay attention to anything I write. But now I have so many other people writing on the blog. Since the last few years, it's been mostly a group blog, and it's had so many other great authors on it that I'm not in the least surprised. You know, it's attracted now very high-profile people. On the other hand, you know, it's although it has, you know, about 100,000 visits a month. You know, there are some in the order of 5 million people who go to work in the healthcare business every day. Mm-hmm. So, you know, they're not all coming to my blog every day, you know, so maybe it could be more, I don't know.
What are some of the challenges you have come into? Or I understand that you have a passion for building community, you know, around healthcare and healthcare IT. Could you maybe talk a bit about what are some of the challenges of building community?
Well, I think part of it is that the healthcare industry is very insular. And I know you're we're going to talk about my work with my colleagues at Health 2.0 shortly, but you know, we're working to try to get some of the innovation that, you know, folks like Apixio, but many others in the world, in the Silicon Valley world, have into the world of healthcare. Healthcare is highly regulated. It's done stuff that the way it's always done it. If you look at the top 10 companies in any industry, you know, top 10 Fortune 500 companies, they tend to change dramatically over the decades. But if you look at the top names in healthcare now, it's what the top names were 50 years ago, and in some cases, even 100 years ago. It's still Mayo Clinic and Johns Hopkins and Blue Cross of this and Blue Cross of that. You know, even Kaiser Permanente, which is kind of quote unquote a newcomer, is more than 60 years old. So, you know, it's problematic to get new interest around that. But there are a lot of people who are very passionate about healthcare from the patient side, from the technology side, and from the service delivery side and insurance side, who are looking at the new world of technology and saying, how can we get involved? And of course, these days, community and interaction around content and with each other is such a huge part of everything that's going on in the world of sort of social media that I think it's been not that hard to introduce that to healthcare, although the outcomes are somewhat different than industries like, you know, music or film or entertainment, where it's completely torpedoed what's been going on before.
So could you talk a bit about you know, how we could bring in more consumer-facing tools into healthcare?
So, I mean, glad you asked that, because Health 2.0 is a conference that I co-founded with Indu Subbiah in 2007 has largely been about that. Although now the sort of ease of use of technologies that, you know, you see in other industries, you know, obviously 2007, by the way, an interesting little device called the iPhone was first introduced then. Pretty recent if you think about it, right? Mm-hmm. But the sort of ease of use of all the applications, the tools, the websites that have been developing over the last few years, that's been happening in many other industries. And now people coming into healthcare are really interested in seeing that in healthcare. And I probably give you one tiny example. So both Indu Sabaya, my co-founder and partner at Health 2.0, and my wife Amanda had babies this last year. And now, young, relatively young women, I won't say their ages, but you know, young professional women who use all these tools in their day-to-day work, but also use them for their leisure activities, are now coming, many of these women are coming to their first big interaction with the healthcare system. And so you've got a whole generation, and they're going to go on becoming, obviously, the healthcare leaders of their families, and they're going to be expecting to see these tools, using them to both manage their own care, going to online communities to find out what other people are experiencing, but now, of course, increasingly importantly, wanting to have the same interaction with their healthcare providers who have been kind of stuck in the dark ages not using those tools. So you're going to see a big change. So I think consumer-driven change and consumer demand is going to be a big reason behind those changes.
So what advice would you give to healthcare startups who are trying to make these changes and trying to overcome some of these challenges to the technology adoption?
So we've been having a little interesting debate on the healthcare blog between me and several of the other writers on this right now, actually. Dave Chase has written an article about what do you do. I think the trick is you've got to find the organizations, the healthcare organizations, who are trying to make that leap. There are a lot of healthcare organizations and healthcare practitioners who are trying to make the leap to use these tools to make this a more consumer-friendly experience compared to how healthcare has been. And some of them are large organizations, and I think the trick is to work with them. It's very hard to create a completely new from scratch healthcare experience because you do need the bricks and mortars. You need the doctors, the nurses, people have to actually have the laying on of hands at some point in the experience. And although there's a lot you can do around that, it's hard to do it without the healthcare establishment. So the trick is to find the right customers and to find the right organizations who want to sort of make the leap and to take to them technology which will make it easier and quicker and more profitable for them to take the leap than to otherwise build themselves.
So could you describe what Health 2.0 means?
Ooh, a lot of people have a lot of different opinions about that. My sense is Health 2.0 is started out as being just simply the easy to use software that's very related to the Web 2.0 software technology, which is software as a service that's provided on demand, that's easy to use, that takes users as co-developers, to use Tim O'Reilly's phrase, I'm from Web 2.0. Mm-hmm. And I think it really started out there. Now it's sort of transforming a bit into a movement where data about individuals, patients, but also data from multiple data sources like government databases about things like disease categories, even things like the weather, even things like disease reporting in different communities, is getting mashed together and easily is becoming available to individuals over a diverse range of devices. We actually call it unplatforms rather than just mobile or device-based or wireless, but over a wide range of devices, including mobile phones, pill boxes that glow in the dark when you haven't taken your pill. It's about information transfer both to the patient, to the individuals, and away from them, back to databases, to help them make better decisions about healthcare.
What kind of gaps do you see between where the potential of technology could be headed and where healthcare is today?
Well, I mean, there is huge, huge potential. You've got to realize that we're living in a country, and by the way, not every country is like this, but we're living in a country where really only about 10 to 15% of physician practices are fully automated, where your record, actually, they have your record, and they can easily go back and search it picks you another plug here, right? Because they do searches into medical records, and I've got to tell you, it's a very small part of the market so far. So that's one thing. We've got to make that gap where we've got to get the providers automated and organized. The other thing we've got to do, which is huge potential, is that most people who use healthcare intensively are sick and tend to be older than on average. And so far, we've basically been creating tools and devices and websites and software that is for people who are good users of software and web devices, and they tend to be younger and more corporate than typical patients. There is a big transformation coming where we're going to make the ease of use and the user experience for people who are older and sicker, that we're going to make their experience much better. And I'd add to that that we also have a huge potential to enable a whole group of people who you might call caregivers or patient advocates to make the process of dealing with the healthcare system much easier and to be kind of the Johnny on the spot, the person who's helping out the patient.
Well, Matthew, let's go to one of our Skype callers, Peter Frischoff. Peter is the founder of Medscape and a digital health entrepreneur who is calling from his country cabin in New Jersey. Here's his question.
What are some of the ways in which clinicians can be paid for all these wonderful new digital technologies that are coming upon us?
So the issue is, if you're not getting paid for something, you won't do it. It's clearly true, and we have a reimbursement system which is set up the wrong way to pay for the wrong things. So we need to change the reimbursement system at two levels. And the first level is nationally, strategically, from the government, and that's kind of slowly starting to happen with the changes in Medicare payments, the ACOs, and elsewhere. The other thing we have to do is really, as technologists, as people in the Health 2.0 movement or elsewhere, people who are building these tools, devices, is to really put the pressure on by showing that it works at a small scale.
Well, that's a great answer. Let's take another question from Rushika Fernando Pule. Dr. Rushika is the president of Eora Health and is the former executive director of the Harvard Interfaculty Program for Health Systems Improvement, calling from Boston.
As you know, you're obviously very familiar with Health 2.0, and there are lots of really neat companies out there who are trying to help consumers connect with each other and understand more about their healthcare. There's also a lot of action in the sort of EHR market. I think the money the federal government's pouring into it, lots of companies building computer products for physicians to document and code and bill and take a look at their clinical material. There's also a lot of action in the sort of the health plan data area, and companies like Verisk and others that sort of analyze claims data and come up with insights. Unfortunately, those three cautious, the sort of patient-centered Health 2.0, the clinical records, the EHRs, and these sort of claims-based records are completely separate companies. The data they're using is completely separate. And there's virtually no one or nothing that can kind of cross all three. And there's obviously reason to think that the real insights would be if you combine those sort of three streams. What will happen to combine these three? Do you see it happening already, or do you think something needs to happen from a policy or business point of view to make it happen?
This is in the EMR world that Rushika is talking about. There are a bunch of startup software as a service-based health 2.0 companies in the EMR space, of whom the Epics and Eclipses and Siemens are not ones. And I think the only real hope to make the leap that Rushika's talking about is to get a large enough base of these people using software as a service or software-enabled services, as they're sometimes called, systems. And these are much more like a Google and a Salesforce than they are like a old world enterprise software. And those tools you can build APIs into, or you have APIs which you can add other tools into. So if you look at the App Store, if you look at Salesforce's force.com, and you're just going to start seeing this from some of these other companies. So I think what the dream that Rushika's looking for is possible. Now, we're again a long way from getting there. Most large hospitals have gone with an Epic or a similar type system, and they're not so flexible, and there's a lot of regulations and a lot of business reasons why they don't want to share their data and make it easier. But I think that if we come back in, maybe not in 2 years, but in 10 years, we'll be really surprised about the things that, well, from 10 years, we'll be staggered that 10 years ago we couldn't do the things that we can do in 2021 or 2022.
You really think in 10 years?
I think in 10 years. I think we're at the tipping point soon, but I think the old world silos of, somebody does EMRs, somebody does consumer stuff badly, and somebody else, a third party, does analysis. Those divisions are going to permeate, just like they have on the rest of the web. It's just going to take a while.
Well, that concludes our time here today. Matt, thank you so much for joining us.
Karen, thanks so much. It's been a great pleasure.
And a special thanks to all our Skype guests. All of our episodes will be available at www.apixio.com. And feel free to submit your questions, ideas, or suggestions to hitvoice@apixio.com. Thanks for being with us.